Professor Dave here. Let's talk about protecting groups.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So let's go ahead and revisit the SN2 reaction once again. Let's say that we have this substrate and we want to react with methoxide. Let's say we have it in our heads. Methoxide, that's going to be good for SN2, and we have a leaving group right here. So let's say that we're going to do this, and this is what we want to get. And so that seems all well and good. That seems like it's going to work. But actually, this is no good. It's not going to go SN2. And let's talk about why. Because not only is this a good nucleophile, it's also a very strong base. And so the thing is, because we have a hydroxyl group right here, this is just acidic enough that a strong base is actually, it's just going to do an acid-base reaction. So this alkoxide, this methoxide, is going to pick up that proton to form methanol, and then we're going to have the alkoxy group right there. We've ruined our nucleophile. We're not going to get any SN2, and so everything is terrible. But what we come to understand is there's ways to manipulate our substrate so that we can do the SN2 that we planned. And the way that we can do that is by protecting the hydroxyl group. So if we protect that alcohol using TBDMS group, this is a tert-butyl dimethyl silyl, because this is a tert-butyl right here, a dimethyl, and then silyl refers to a silicon atom. This is actually going to work as a protecting group for that hydroxyl group, so it will temporarily shield it from any unwanted acid-base chemistry. We can do the SN2 we wanted and then deprotect it and get it back to normal. So let's take a look at how this mechanism works. So let's say we have our substrate that we were looking at before, and then here is our, this is called TBDMS-Cl, right? We've got our tert-butyl dimethyl silyl group there, and then the chloro group there. Okay, so what's going to happen is the oxygen atom is more labile than the chlorine atom, so this is actually going to be able to displace the chlorine. The oxygen is more electronegative, so it is actually going to be able to attack the silicon atom and displace the chlorine. So now we have this whole TBDMS group on that substrate. So remember, this is TBDMS, right? So we can actually abbreviate that as TBDMS bound to the oxygen atom and then the rest of the substrate. Now, here's what's very interesting about putting this protecting group on the hydroxyl. Remember how before, whether it was some base or whatever it was, we were worried about an acid-base reaction with the nucleophile and that hydroxyl proton. Well, guess what? There is no longer a hydroxyl proton. This oxygen is not bound to hydrogen anymore. It's bound to a silicon atom. So there is no longer a proton that is acidic enough to react with whatever base or nucleophile we might be trying to use to do an SN2 reaction. So now there's no worries. Let's do an SN2 reaction. Let's say KCN, whatever it is, doesn't matter. So here we go. We did our SN2 reaction. So the SN2 reaction is now complete without any interference from the hydroxyl group. Now that we've achieved that, we do want to get our hydroxyl group back. So remember how we said that oxygen was more labile than silicon, so the oxygen the oxygen-silicon bond was able to replace the silicon-chlorine bond. Well, now this fluoride is more labile than even the oxygen. So a fluoride can come in here, boom, attack the silicon, kick that off, then that's going to protonate. Let's say it gets a proton from solvent somewhere, and then we're going to get our hydroxyl back. So all we did was we used TBDMS-Cl to protect the hydroxyl group. This is now protected. There is no hydroxyl proton there to participate in any acid-base reaction. We used that protected version of the substrate to do whatever SN2 we wanted, doesn't matter what it was. We achieved the SN2. Once we did that, we deprotect with TBAF. This is tetrabutyl ammonium fluoride, and that's because the fluoride can then displace the silicon oxygen bond. Oxyanion gets protonated from solvent, and there we go. We have our deprotected alcohol back to normal, and with the SN2 that we wanted to do, achieved. Now, we looked at protecting groups for hydroxyl groups, but there's protecting groups for pretty much any functional group you can think of. So let's look at one more. Let's look at a protecting group for an aldehyde or ketone. So let's say we want to achieve, once again, this is always about some kind of transformation we want to achieve, but there's a different functional group that's going to mess it up, right? So let's say we have this substrate here, and we want to specifically reduce this ester. We want to reduce this ester to the primary alcohol. We really want to do that for whatever synthetic pathway we're doing. Who cares why? But here's the problem. We've got a ketone right there. There's no way we're going to get lithium aluminum hydride to selectively reduce the ester and not the ketone. It's just going to reduce whatever it sees first. So we wouldn't get this product, and this reaction's not going to work. But here's the thing. What if we protect that carbonyl, specifically the ketone? So what we're going to do is we can react in acidic conditions with this 1,2 ethane diol. We have this vicinal diol here. Now, I'm not going to write out the whole mechanism explicitly because this has to do with acetal formation, and you can check out my acetal tutorial to see this very explicit mechanism. But let's just say that that mechanism occurs, and what ends up happening is we get this acetal here, okay? And so the reason that this attacks over here and not over there is because this is a little bit more electrophilic at the time, because this carbonyl carbon is receiving extra electron density from the lone pairs on that oxygen. So this is less electrophilic than here, so this ethane diol will explicitly undergo acetal formation at this site. Now, the reason that this is useful is because this carbon still has two carbon-oxygen bonds, so we would still consider it electrophilic. But if you look at the vectors, the dipole on this bond, it has two carbon-oxygen bonds in the same direction. So that is why a carbonyl carbon is very electrophilic, because it has two carbon-oxygen bonds. It has its electrons being withdrawn away from it by two bonds and in the same direction. But if we do this, then it becomes two vectors that are like this, and so they're not any longer unidirectional. This greatly reduces the electrophility of that carbon, electrophilicity of that carbon. It's a little bit closer to the electrophilicity of, say, a hydroxyl carbon, which is not susceptible to nucleophilic attack by hydride or anything else. So we have effectively protected that ketone carbonyl. Now we have lithium aluminum hydride. It's not going to mess with that because it has become not electrophilic enough to be reduced. So instead, we're going to reduce right here. We're going to reduce just the ester that we wanted. So we see that there is the reduced, we've got that primary alcohol. Now, a little bit of acidic conditions, we're going to be able to deprotect and get back our ketone. And so what we've done, just the way we did with the hydroxyl, we knew that we didn't want some unwanted chemistry here, so we protected that area, and then we went ahead and did the chemistry that we wanted to do in the first place, and then we deprotected this to get back over here. So now we have methods for protection of hydroxyl groups as well as ketones and aldehydes. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.